sermon today on the subject, a subject which has been relatively important. It continues to remain important over some long period of time, and that subject is freedom of speech. I hope that you will see that the sermonette will relate into the sermon, and that if we're being transformed, we're going to be different from the world. Freedom of speech is one of the things that we find a core value, at least in the Western world, of what our principles are. Freedom of speech. Without it, nothing could exist in the way that it does. Recently in Paris, we had the leaders of the Western democracies, and I put in parentheses here, except for the U.S., because the leader of the U.S. didn't go to support this, but the leaders of the Western democracies, by and large, locked arms and walked down one of the main streets of Paris, demonstrating that their arms were locked together, that they were in absolute support, and it could not be broken between them, of the whole concept of freedom of speech. Might be one of the few things not being there that I would agree with President Obama about, because I don't think probably the reason for which he didn't go was one I would agree with. But I don't know that I would agree about marching in support of freedom of speech, at least not as we know it. Situation which brought that about, I'm sure most of you are aware of it, but I'll refresh you a little bit. There was a publication in Paris named Charlie. Charlie was a satirical publication, and they put out rather scurrilous cartoons about many things, but they had recently put out a particularly scurrilous and pornographic cartoon about the Prophet Muhammad as the Muslim world viewed it. And so, as a result of that, certain of the Muslim radicals broke into the office of that publication, shot and killed a number of people on the publication staff. It was a statement that you do not have freedom of speech to portray our religion or our religious leaders in the way that you are doing it. In fact, the only kind of freedom that you have is portray them in a very positive light, as we do. That's where the restriction on your freedom begins. As I said, the cartoons were scurrilous. Everybody seemed to have agreed with that. They were scurrilous and they were pornographic. But yet, the leaders of all of the Western nations marched down the street in support of Charlie's right to do these kinds of things. Freedom of speech and freedom of the press, freedom of publication, is one of the fundamental core values of our society and of the Western nations. I would hasten to add that the rest of the world doesn't necessarily share in those values, and the fact that we have freedom of religion is a fairly recent value that has come to pass in the last couple of hundred years, and starting in the United States, and I'll talk about some of that as we go. But the question that we'll be driving at is, do we, when I say we, God's church, have freedom of speech? So let's look at the Bible. We'll be looking at also a couple or three other sources for which we choose to reflect or choose to use to invoke this right. And I'll have to limit the discussion. I could say, of course, Manny Perdo, when I met him, he told me that he was a Jew. He is a Jew. He didn't transform himself in that regard, at least. He was a Jew living in Armenia at the time when Jews were extremely persecuted in Armenia. And I doubt, for example, that they had any sort of freedom of speech there. You can look at places like China, going back into the time of Mao Zedong, no freedom of speech. By comparison, the Russian-speaking world throughout the time of the Soviet Union had little freedom of speech. Varying degrees of speech are found in different places, different venues throughout the world. But I can't address all of those places. So each one deserve to be addressed to the people in those places, but mostly I'm addressing those of you in the United States who are used to the culture and the values that we have. And so we're going to be limiting the discussion of freedom of speech in this case to those of us in the Western culture, maybe more than just in the United States, but the British Commonwealth of Nations and Western Europe in places like Germany and Netherlands and those Western nations where they proclaim the right to speak freely about all sort of things. The historical model, going back, I say it's only been a couple of hundred years, I've calculated out 224 years ago now, since a statement was put forth which led to the belief that we had freedom of speech. The historical society, the historical model of Western societies up until maybe even a century ago revolved around what is known as the divine right of kings. The divine right of kings was a belief that God had provided to certain people he had selected to be the kings over nations, a divine right to make and administer the law. Genesis chapter 49, I'll show you some of the biblical basis for that, because this model has a biblical base. And we may think of the divine right of kings as being outdated, old, useless, and passé. But let's take a look at it, and mostly we wouldn't even consider that it has a biblical base at all. But it does, I would submit to you, have a biblical base. So let's take a look at what we might consider as the biblical basis for the divine right of kings. Genesis chapter 49 and verse 10. Now in this verse of scripture, Israel had called all of his sons into his presence just prior to his death, and he was giving them prophetically information about where they would be and what would be the circumstances in their lives at the end of the age. Now the end of the age was from that time on, probably 4,000 years. I didn't calculate that and look at it, but perhaps 4,000 years out into the future, he would say, these are the prophecies that I have for each one of you. And he prefaced it by saying, this is the things that will be happening to you and where you will be at the end of the age. So that makes these prophecies very, very interesting to us, because if he is telling about the end of the age, we are surely in the end of the age now, and these prophecies would be relating to those of us now in this present world. He said to Judah, one of the supreme promises, maybe the supreme promise, that he made to any of the 12 tribes, the 12 sons that he had. He said to Judah, the man Judah, who represented all the descendants that would come from him and ultimately would exist on the face of the earth at this time, the scepter shall not depart from Judah. Now, what was the scepter and why was that being said? Well, the scepter is a kind of a staff that a king holds in his hand, which is indicative of the supreme power of a king. It is a symbol that the king has power. The scepter will not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet. Well, a lawgiver, a scepter is a king, a lawgiver is one who institutes the law until Shiloh come. What is Shiloh? And when is Shiloh coming, or has Shiloh come? Well, Shiloh is another word for Christ. The Judah, the scepter would not depart from Judah, that he would not be without a lawgiver until the time that Christ came and the kingdom of God was established. Now, that the last time I checked, that hasn't come yet. But it is coming into this age. He's saying to Judah, and to him, to Shiloh or Christ, shall the gathering of the people be. Concept here, God, this is where the divine right of kings, one of the places where we might go and look, there could be a few of them. One of the places where God had ordained, or at least these people took it as an indication that God had ordained certain people to be kings. The rest of the citizens were under the obligation from God to accept and support that king as a part of the model and the structure that came from God himself. They were under that sort of obligation, the peasants and so forth of the Middle Ages. Further than that, down the road, a considerable period of time from Israel and the going into the time when the Israelites went into Egypt, there came King David. He was the second king of Israel. Saul was the first king. David was the second king. Solomon was the third king. David was given a promise by God. Now, you can find enough information about that promise in 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 16 and 17. God said to David, at the time that David wanted to build a temple, wanted to build a house for God, he said, we have our houses, all you have is a tent. I want to build a house for you, God, for your tabernacle to stay, and a place for you, a magnificent place such as you deserve to be in. And God appreciated that on the part of David so deeply that he made a promise to David. Verse 16, your house and your kingdom shall be established forever before you. Your throne shall be established forever. Now that's a long time. It goes right through the present age, all the way up until the kingdom of God. And then we might think that this is the model for which the kingdom of God will be followed. And so, there's a biblical basis to the divine right of kings. According to all these words, and according to all this vision, so did Nathan speak to David. Here's the extension of logic. You know, here's the logical part of the part a logical conclusion on the part of those people who came to the notion that kings have a divine right. And of course, kings liked that, and so they promoted that in their own behalf. Since God has given the king the power, it was therefore the king's right to determine which and to what extent he would extend rights to the citizens. So this is the thing. All power, all authority, all law was vested in the king. Divine right of kings. Now, to the extent that he felt it was appropriate, that it was beneficial to him and hopefully to his subjects as well, he could extend certain amounts of that power to those people in his society, which he was ruling over. There was a problem with freedom of speech. Freedom of speech was really not something that a king would want to sort of disseminate to his subjects, because in freedom of speech existed the potential power to rebel against the king. So the extent to which freedom of speech would normally have been found in these kingdoms was not to the extent that you could criticize politically the king or the king and his court. And so freedom of speech did not exist in the same way that we have it in our society today, because all power was vested in the king. The king could restrict that power in any way that he wanted to. So that's a very, very important thing to note about the divine right of kings and the society that existed. As I said, there was a biblical basis for this model. Now, I can point out to you, I don't know, perhaps many of you know it, but there was a movie called Braveheart. In that movie, one of the two main characters, William Wallace, continually made the statement in that movie about Robert the Bruce, that he was only going to support Robert the Bruce for the king because it was rightfully his. He was rightly the one to be king. There were a number of people contending to be the king of Scotland at that time, but Wallace kept making that statement about Robert the Bruce. Robert the Bruce treated Wallace very, very badly, and yet Wallace continued to make that statement. Why Wallace continued to make that statement, apparently it's never explained or even really inferred in the movie, unless you have ears to hear what Wallace was saying. Where would he get the right? How was it that he was rightly designated in the mind of Wallace to be the king? Well, the fact is, if you go to look at some of the charts, Robert the Bruce existed in the lineage of the kings of England, and he was a descendant of David. Now here we read about God promising that there would always be a king to sit on the throne, and a descendant of David would be a king on the throne forever. And so Wallace was taking that, apparently, never an explanation from the movie, but apparently Wallace felt that Robert Bruce had to be king because he was a descendant of David. That's just, if you have seen that movie or if you plan to see it, Mel Gibson playing the part of William Wallace. And if you, by the way, if you ever go to Edinburgh, to the castle there in Scotland, as you enter the door to the castle, on one side of the castle is a statue of Robert the Bruce, and on the other side of the entryway to the castle is a statue of William Wallace. So you walk between William Wallace and Robert the Bruce going into that castle. Judah's scepter and Joseph's birthright. In the back of that book, and we just quoted here that Genesis 49 and verse 10, scepter shall not depart from Judah. So Judah's scepter is referring to the fact that the kingship through all of time was to belong to Judah, Judah's scepter. And and so in that book, it was portrayed, and if you look in the back of that book, you will see a line of people descending from David, and actually descending from the man Judah, all the way down to the present king and queen of Great Britain. Now, when we were in Britain, I think probably 15, 20 years ago now, we went to Edinburgh, to Westminster Chapel, Westminster Abbey, in London, and we looked because we had seen pictures there in Westminster Abbey of the lineages posted, that the British royal family posted and traced their lineage back all the way to David. But they weren't there anymore. Those placards had been taken down. And yet, if you look in Judah's scepter and Joseph's birthright, you will see that lineage traced out. Divine right of kings. It was the model of the time up until 240 years ago, and then a transformation, we might say, began to take place in the way freedom in general was regarded. That began with a document which we revere in the United States greatly, the Declaration of Independence. Now, there was a radically different theology, and these are theologies, I would say. One is the divine right of king. God has given kings the right to administer the law based on what was said to Judah, what was said to David, and the descendants of those kings. So that's a theology. That was how society revolved as a result of that. But a radically different theology came to the forefront with the Declaration. With the Declaration of Independence. Here's the way it was set forth. That was not a statement. At least about the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal and endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the governed. So we take that last phrase and we can look at it. This is a theology too. You see how God was invoked? Every phrase in that declaration. The first paragraph is what we felt was, you know, a statement that we felt was necessary to put forth our opinions. But then, as soon as the statement that it was there was a reason for writing this document, this is the way the document, the context of the document kicks off. It is a theology. There's really astronomically and incredibly different from the theology that had existed under the divine right of kings and still continued to exist under the divine right of kings and to a certain extent continues to exist to this day, even though there's been a gradual transformation of it and sort of a melting of that doctrine down to where it is today. This states that there's a very different relationship between God and man. See, under the divine right of kings, the relationship between man and God came through the king. Everything was dependent on the king. God was working with the king. The people were subject to the king. Statement here. Is that there was no king between God and the people. So that's a statement that is being made, and that is what is radically different. Radically different. Here at the end of this really elongated sentence, it says, governments are instituted from among, it means by men. Men themselves decide if they need to be governed, what the nature of that government should be, and how they should inaugurate and put into power that government. And then the purpose of government, according to this statement, is to secure the rights that God had given not to the king, but to the individual citizens of the nation. And not only them, but to every man on the face of the earth, man, woman, and child on the face of the earth, they all had certain rights which came directly from God to them, no king between them. They didn't have to depend on the king for their rights. They had their rights because God had endowed them. Radical, different theology. And I'd say it is a theology between what was said in the Declaration of Independence and what had been extant up until that time. And as you might imagine, this did not cause great agreement or a great deal of acceptance among the nations of Europe as a result of that at the time. Here's some other aspects of it. Truth. It invokes the fact that there is such a thing as truth. And it states there that truth is at the center of the relationship between God and men. By and large, the world around us today does not accept the fact that there is such a thing as truth. Your opinion is as good as my opinion. We can all have our own opinions, and there is essentially no truth, especially at a religious perspective, which is to say, since there is no truth that we can depend on, it is virtually a statement that there is no God. Where we invoke something that says there is truth, we are making a statement that there is a God who is the author of that truth. It is a statement of belief about God found right in the beginning phrase of the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths. Christ said he is the way, the truth, and the life. Truth stands eternally and cannot be revoked, because the source of truth is God. And if there is a source of truth, everybody's opinion cannot be equal. There's only one that is true. Now, the writers of the Declaration, and they argued among themselves a lot at the adoption of this document, nevertheless said that these truths are self-evident. They didn't want to go into showing the proof. They said they're as plain as the nose on your face. All men are created equal. That's part of what they're saying is the truth. Not a king, not somebody in between, but that all men have been endowed, they go on to say, with the same rights directly from their Creator. Unalienable rights. And they go on to enumerate some of those. They do also, it's part of the theology here, I would point out to you, invoke the word Creator. They're saying that God created men, and they're hearkening back here. I don't think there can be any doubt about it. They're hearkening back to the Bible and to the creation of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And that's what they're making this statement boldly as the founders of this nation, that all men are created and endowed by their Creator. Evolution? They're making evolution is Johnny come lately by comparison. But they're making a statement here that everything was created, and we were given as a part of the creation those inalienable rights. Rights do not, they're saying, come from a king. Rights come to you and I. And they bypass the President of the United States, whoever he may happen to be, the King of England, whoever he may happen to be, the King of any other nation, Mao Zedong in China, that the rights come, they're saying, to every human being over the face of the earth as a result of the fact that there are human beings who have been created by God and endowed with those rights. It's radical. It's radical. There is a contrast between these two models. Never before, I say never with question marks, I put three question marks after it because I don't know for sure. I'm making a statement, but I don't know of any time when, ever before, men had felt that their rights were completely independent from a king or a government. Now, what the Declaration here says in this paragraph is that men having these rights can then take some of the rights that they have been given from God and they can lend those rights to a government. Purpose for lending those rights to a government, they state the purpose for it here in this one sentence, to secure the rights that God has given. That's the purpose of it. They're saying, government, we have to have a government, and we want a government to secure the rights that God has granted to us, so that nobody, even a king, can take those rights away. Now, an opinion, these men who signed the Declaration of Independence felt that freedom of speech was one of the rights which God endowed to man. So out of the culture, of the divine right of kings, came the Declaration of Independence, and the Revolutionary War, and the establishment of a government in the United States. First government in the United States failed. It was called the Articles of Confederation, and as a result, a proposal was made, and it was a scurrilous proposal at the time, that a republic would be formed, a constitution would be written, that the men who were selected to the Constitutional Convention would meet together and write a new constitution. And they met behind closed doors. They nailed the shutters shut because it was such a controversial matter among the people. Because there was this concept that we would have an imperial country. Once again, we would be somehow returning to a leader which was like unto a king. And I'd have to say in retrospect that didn't happen perhaps in the first 50-100 years, but in the last 100 years, it has continually moved in that direction. They wrote a little document, Constitution of the United States, and in some years gone by, the 200th anniversary, we took Wild Mueller's down to Philadelphia, and it was a 200th anniversary celebration there. They had a skit, which they played out, which was called The Three Little Pages. Now, Three Little Pages, why was it The Three Little Pages? Because the whole Constitution of the United States was written on a document 3 pages long. It sort of causes you to smile when we see laws, individual laws, regulating a subset, a relatively small subset of the government being thousands of pages long. They were able to do it on 3 pages. But it was going to be a difficulty passing this law, this Constitution, adopting the Constitution, becoming a nation under this Constitution was going to be a difficulty because so many people feared it, feared what the result would be. So a proposal was made that we will doubly state some of the feelings which are partly fears, reflecting fears of the people, but also an impediment to the adoption of the Constitution. And so they came up with a Bill of Rights. In the Bill of Rights are 10 amendments to the Constitution. The first amendment to the Constitution involved establishing freedom of speech. Here's the way the First Amendment of the Constitution reads. The First Amendment to the United States Constitution prohibits making any law respecting, first of all, religion. No law respecting an establishment of religion, impeding the free exercise of religion, abridging freedom of speech, infringing on freedom of the press, interfering with the right to peaceably assemble or prohibit the petition for a government redress of grievances. It was adopted December 15th, 1791. And so the Bill of Rights was passed December 15, 1791 as a measure primarily to overcome adoption to the passage of the U.S. Constitution. Specifically to be doubly sure that Congress could not ever, even though they were already prohibited by the Constitution, they could never lawfully take away these rights. Freedom of religion was the first one, and then right after that was freedom of speech. If, as we say, God is the direct source of our rights. That's what we said in the Declaration of Independence, isn't it? That our rights come to the individual from God. I don't know of anybody who today looks to God for a definition of those rights, for the limitation on those rights, for the application of those rights, and we're talking here about freedom of speech. Does God define for us what is freedom of speech? How much freedom of speech is allowable? How much does He grant to us? How are we to use that in wisdom? And how is it the Bible sets forth that matter as a whole? We're not looking. As a society, we said our rights come from God to the man. We can do anything we want to. One of those rights is freedom of speech. We'll decide for ourselves what is appropriate in the matter of freedom of speech. If you look at logic, if God is the author of that, shouldn't we have looked to God to define for us what that right is, how that right affects us, how we can use it in accordance with God's law, and how we should be obedient to God and His wishes? But it never seems to, among those men who wrote the Constitution, to have gone beyond the fact that we have the right to do as we please. If it did, I don't know about it. And perhaps some did make some argument about that. I don't know. Since that Bill of Rights was written, since the First Amendment was passed, 224 years have ensued, in which we argued, disagreed, and fought over what constitutes freedom of speech. We have been without regard for God. We have disagreed, we have disregarded what God has said about the matter. And nobody bothers to even look and see, except we need to look and see. And it's not an easy subject to look at and to see, not in a short space of time. But I thought we needed the background to see what happened and where we stand, in order to show the importance of being very, very different, being transformed from this world and not conformed to the world which is around us. If we say God is the direct source of our rights, and it says that in the Declaration of Independence, nobody subscribes to that very much anymore, but if we do say that God is the direct source of our rights, who determines those rights and sets limits on them? Well, of course, God has the right to do that. He has not yet taken the restriction of those rights and applied them to mankind in the way that He will. Results today. Our freedom of speech, we can just look at it. What freedom of speech apart from God, and whether or not there is even any such thing as freedom of speech taught in the Bible, that's a whole other matter. But the results today of freedom of speech, we see all of the Western leaders of the world marching down the streets of Paris, locked arm in arm, to demonstrate they cannot be separated from this principle, freedom of speech. given us? Freedom of speech has given us what? Pornography? Of course. We have pornography. That's artistic expression. We cannot say, because we have freedom of speech, we cannot say that you can't have these kinds of things. Freedom of speech has given us libel. You can say anything that you want to, any scurrilous kind of thing that you want to against a public figure, and that cannot be confronted in a court of law as to whether or not it is true because of freedom of speech. As you're pretty much free speech-wise, by the definitions that man has come up with, to speak anything you want to against a public figure. The correctness or incorrectness of what you have to say is not something you can be held responsible for. Such widely diverse things, freedom of speech it's been argued anyway, campaign finance. What about freedom of speech in political campaigns? Can interminable amounts of money be brought in to overwhelm your opponent under the banner of freedom of speech? What about profanity? You know, there was a time when profanity was not allowed on the movie screens of the theater. And in fact, Gone with the Wind, I think it was 1939 or something like that, Academy Award winner, it was the most scandalous thing because Rhett Butler, the character there in the movie, at the end of the movie, in separating himself from Scarlett O'Hara, made the following statement. Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn. And so people went to see that movie just to hear that word said. And now, what is there? Profanity is everywhere. Freedom of speech. We have freedom of speech. These are the kinds of things, and we could go on and on about freedom of speech. These are the kind of things that freedom of speech has given to us, has bequeathed to us as its legacy. And we have a constitutional government founded as a result of the Declaration of Independence. It says, we have been endowed from God with certain inalienable rights. And we would think one of those rights is freedom of speech. I just thought about this. There was a song. It was a very popular song written by Kris Kristofferson back, I don't know, 30 years ago anyway, maybe longer. Me and Bobby McGee. And there's a line in that song, not just about freedom of speech, but about freedom in general. And a whole generation of people from the 60s on took to themselves a kind of freedom that had not been extant in our society up until that time. There was freedom of all kinds of things. There was sexual freedom. There was, the freedom of speech that we talk about. There was the freedom to rebel. There was freedom in the movies and in the musical world. There was a kind of freedom that was exposed everywhere, and a whole generation bought into that freedom. Kris Kristofferson sings this song about he and his friend Bobby McGee. And he made this statement, and I think it's a pretty profound statement. After having lived this lifestyle where they were completely free from all restrictions and they thought they truly had the freedom that they sought. Freedom's just another line. This is what is written in the song and sung in the song very effectively, I think. Freedom's just another word for nothing left to lose. Freedom ain't worth nothing, but it's free. And you can look at the litany of what freedom of speech has given to us. And I would say, it ain't worth nothing, but it's free. God has restrictions. This is what we should have as a nation have transitioned from when we said our rights come from God. Then we should have said, what are those rights? Where are those rights established? Those rights are established in the Bible. The nation didn't do that. We as a church need to do that. I'll just give you a rundown of only a few. I can't be exhaustive in this regard because there are so many restrictions to freedom of speech which are given to us in the Bible. I want to point your head into looking at and thinking about those things and being transformed by the renewing of your mind and look at those things and to understand where you need to go so that you are not conformed to this world and the freedoms of this world, one of which is freedom of speech. Christianity begins, and I'll give you a rundown on four or five different places here in the Bible, and you will have to go and look for other places, and there are many, many of them, where you are instructed about your speech. And you need to take from that instruction how and what and why you utilize one of the great gifts of God, your ability to speak and to communicate. Christianity begins. Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, verse 22. Christ said, talking about anger toward another brother, I say to you, whoever is angry with his brother without cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And, here's your speech, here's the speech part. Whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, worthless person, shall be in danger of counsel. So there's a counsel there that they could bring you before for saying something like that to a brother. That was a counsel that was administered by human beings, I suppose. But whosoever shall say, you fool, to call another person a fool, is in danger of hellfire. Is that freedom of speech or is that restricting our freedom of speech? Still in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, verse 33. Again, it says, another expose that he's giving in this presentation called the Sermon on the Mount. You have heard that it has been said of them of old time, you shall not forswear yourself, but shall perform unto the Lord your oaths. But I got something different to say to you. You heard it said of old. That's kind of the construct here of the Sermon of the Mount. You've heard it said, it is written, I say. Here Christ says, I say to you, do not swear at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne. And we look at this, and in particular, I think of the word swear here, and all of our documents in this country are written around swearing something is true. I swear that the document I put my name to here is true. You go into a court of law, they say, put your left hand on the Bible, raise your right hand, and repeat after me. I solemnly swear, the testimony I'm about to give, it's the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God, swearing. Swearing in the way that really fits the context here. Do not swear at all. Don't use heaven, for it is God's throne. And here we start thinking about swearing, not in the same way as we might in a court of law, but using profanity. Don't say, for example, it's saying here, my heavens, or my stars, or something of that nature. Thought about in regard to this, we were recently at the theater in New York, and Javert in Les Mis, who represents the law, comes out and sings a very, very powerful song saying he swears by the stars that he will be there to catch Jean Valjean, and he will never relent. And he swears that. By heaven. Then don't do it. You're taking God's name in vain. You're approaching the taking of God's name in vain, because that's where God's throne is. Nor by the earth. Likewise, it is his footstool, and we've known over generations things like my lands, or to use the word hell, which is a euphemistic word, which we don't use anymore. We don't understand in the same way, but it means earth or grave. Nor by the earth, it is his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king, neither shall you swear by your head. And I guess people have done that, because they have no power over their head. They cannot make one hair black or white. Here is really a restriction on freedom of speech. Keep your communication simple and to the point. Let your communication be yes, yes, or no, no. And here's an awesome restriction on our communication, because we have to emphasize everything by making some reference which will be emphatic in our statement. But it's what it says here. Whatsoever is more than this, you don't want to be associated with it. You want to be transformed, not conformed. Comes from evil. So has God granted us freedom of speech? A lot of restrictions. We have a gift from God to communicate. Is it freedom of speech? I think we have to be careful in saying that God gave us freedom of speech, because our concept of freedom of speech is something that God would not at all want us to do. Gossip, that's freedom of speech, isn't it? And I think it's one of the biggest problems in the church and among the membership of the church. People talking about other people in the church for little, minor, useless things. Is that acceptable with God, or has God restricted that kind of speech? We don't have to obey it. I say, unfortunately, as a church, more and more as time goes on, we are gossiping to a greater and greater extent. That's been my history in the church. James, we look at James as being the place where we would go and look at gossip. James chapter 1, verse 26. If any man among you seems to be religious, but does not bridle his tongue, freedom of speech, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is worthless. So if you don't have control of your tongue, forget about God. That's what it's saying. This man's religion is vain. Chapter 3. Let's go quickly through a few verses here in James chapter 3. In many things we offend. If any man offends not in word, Are our words to be offensive? That's a pretty important restriction on speech. We're not to give offense in our communication except as it is necessary according to the law of God. We don't have that kind of freedom. God doesn't give us that kind of freedom. In fact, He really demands of us the opposite. If any man offend not in word, this is a big statement. If we don't use any offensive words, if any man offend not at all in word, the same is a perfect man. Who is a perfect man? Darn it. Every man is required to control the freedom by which he uses his tongue, being transformed by the renewing of your mind. You went through a process of renewal 2 weeks ago, and now, having gone through that, you be transformed, metamorphized, and not conformed back to this world where you find all of these things under the banner of freedom of speech. The same as a perfect man and able also to bridle the whole body. So this is the hardest thing. That's the hardest thing in you to control. If you can control that, you can control every part of you. Behold, we put bits in horses' mouths, verse 3, and that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold, also ships are driven by fierce winds, yet they are turned by a very small helm. Whithersoever the governor listeth. Whoever pulls that thing around turns that ship in the direction that it's going. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. Behold, how great a fire, how great a matter a little fire kindles. The tongue is a fire. Freedom of speech? A world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature and is set on fire of hell. Verse 8, the tongue can no man tame. We are required to do it. If we get our rights from God, and God has given us the right to use speech, He has restricted it dramatically to doing things that are within His will. Jude 1, verse 8, some more. Jude writes about leaders in churches at his time. He says, filthy drinkers, defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. We had a lot of speaking of evil and dignities under the banner of freedom of speech, don't we? Verse 9 is the example that is set for us. Michael, the archangel, when he was contending even with Satan the devil, I mean, who would be more deserving of something like this than Satan the devil? Contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses. He said, he didn't say anything, did not bring a railing accusation against Satan, but said, the Lord rebuke you. So I hope you see what's being said there, example that's being said. And you can, and again, I'm not trying to be here exhaustive in relationship to the restrictions that God has given us having to do with freedom of speech, but just setting forth places and calling to your attention, hoping that as you look and examine your Bible, you will see the difference. That your mind will give you the spirit of discernment, that you will be transformed and not conformed. Psalms, the last one I'll give you, Psalms chapter 1 and verse 1. Because this is extremely prevalent in the world around us today. Blessed is the man who doesn't walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners. There's that walking, standing, and then sitting in the seat of the scornful. How much in conversation is scorn used these days? Do we have the freedom to be scornful of other people or of other institutions or things which we don't like? I think that's a restriction God has put on our freedom of speech. We're not to be scornful. I thought about William Wallace in the movie Braveheart screaming freedom at the end of the movie. We received a kind of freedom, brother. We received freedom from Satan and the evil of this world. We left Egypt. Romans chapter 6, verse 16, Paul says, "Don't you know that whom you yield yourselves servants to obey, whose servants you are, to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death?" And we were servants of sin, leading unto death. We have left that behind us, and now we are servants of obedience, which leads unto righteousness. God be thanked, you were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you. And being made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. Now I want to point out to you here, you see how many times the word servant is used in these three verses. The word is not servant. The word is doulos. D-U-L-O-S. And it's translated here in a milder form to kind of make us, accept that. You are not a servant, according to what the context of this means. You are a slave. You are a doulos, a slave. And at one point, you were a slave of sin. You were enslaved by sin. You have been freed from that slavery, but you took on another kind of slavery. You took on the slavery which is characterized here as the slave of righteousness. In fact, what the Bible is telling us, brethren, is that we gave away our freedom, including our freedom of speech, as the world understands it anyway, and we have chosen slavery. Peter says the same thing in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, where he introduces his letter to a church. Simon Peter, a doulos, a slave, and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. The world has its concept of freedom of speech. By contrast, we are the doulos of Christ. We're not to be conformed to the world, we're to be transformed, and that transformation comes about in the process of the renewing of our mind. Bible is quite clear. The proper use of speech is critically important. We are to reflect the character of our Master, the Lord Jesus Christ. We are to reflect that and to follow not only follow His example, but to follow the instruction in that regard that He gave. Paul writes, this will be the last scripture I give you, Colossians chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. Redeem means to buy back that which was lost. Buy back that which was lost. Redeem the time. And here's how you do that. Or here's a characteristic of doing that, at least. Let your speech be always with grace and seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. Today's freedom of speech is the slavery of Satan the devil.